and welcome everybody to the week two video review for our Understanding Language, Learning and Teaching MOOC. My name's Jo Dixon. I've taught English for almost 20 years, mostly here in Southampton, but also overseas. And I'm currently a PhD student here at the University of Southampton. So let's take a look at what's been happening this week in the course. We've got over 800 of you with us, which is fantastic, and over half of you, some 425 of you, have posted comments. Some of you have only recently joined us, so welcome if you've joined the course late, and if you're still discussing week one topics, that's absolutely fine. Carry on at your own pace. A few of you have also got ahead of the rest of us and have started to comment on week three, that's also fine. And congratulations to the six people who have already finished the course. You're entitled to purchase a certificate of participation if you're interested. So we've had some 2,700 comments just on the week two topics this week. And the topics have been based around different approaches to teaching and learning. We started off by looking at different classrooms. Now, unfortunately, due to a technical problem, you've not been able to share photos of your classrooms on the Padlet walls, as we suggested. Apologies for that. The Padlet walls are now working, so please do go ahead and share those pictures if you want to. It's always really interesting to hear about different people's classrooms, and we've had lots of written descriptions of your classrooms. Thank you for those. I think they highlight just how broad a range of different contexts and backgrounds people come from to this course, and that's a very fitting place to start any discussion of approaches to learning and teaching, because I think that your context and your background is going to impact on how you respond to different ideas. So one of the ideas that we discussed was the difference between naturalistic language learning and classroom-based language learning. Overall, I think people feel that naturalistic learning, that is learning outside of the classroom through spontaneous real-life language use, or classroom activities that simulate that classroom activities that are more authentic and more communicative, are more beneficial to confidence and fluency in particular, while more traditional classroom-based learning has a role to play in encouraging people to consider the form and structure of the language and helping people to understand how the language works and to use it with more grammatical accuracy. So overall, people felt that both were useful, although perhaps different approaches more useful to some than others, and perhaps that depended on a lot of different variables. One comment in that step, which particularly caught my eye, was a comment by Christine Williams, who brought up the topic of literacy. While people may be able to develop aspects of a spoken language in a naturalistic way, it's very rare that people develop high levels of literacy without instruction. Now that's a topic that particularly interests me and that's not really a heavy focus of this course. So if anyone would like to share ideas, I'm particularly interested in adults developing literacy for the first time in a foreign language. So that is adults who may not have had the opportunity to go to school and develop literacy skills in their own language, who then find themselves living in a literate culture and struggling to learn a language and develop literacy in that foreign language, not having had the experience of doing that in their home language as a child. If anyone has insights or experience in that area, I'd be very interested to hear from you. Okay, this week we've also discussed task-based learning and teaching. Some people were concerned that might involve a lot of extra preparation for the teacher. On the other hand, in step 2.10, we looked at a picture story, and you all came up with all sorts of very creative and very varied ideas for how that might be used, which demonstrates, I think, that even quite a simple and quick to prepare resource could be stretched and reused in a lot of different classrooms in different ways. So perhaps it doesn't always need to involve a huge amount of preparation. Finally, we looked at CLIL, Content and Language Integrated Learning. The discussions in step 2.12 on this were very interesting. I think there were a lot of different opinions discussed about the possible effectiveness or not of this approach, with people suggesting that the role of the teacher is very important in making sure a task is effective, others stressing that you need to consider the purpose, the learner's purpose in learning the language. One concern that I found interesting was the idea that if a learner is struggling with the foreign language, they are kind of doubly disadvantaged, possibly, by studying another subject through the medium of that language. They may then start to struggle in that subject. And one of our other mentors, Joshua Underwood, posted some interesting links on that topic, which are worth checking out if you're interested. You'll find the links also at the bottom of this step. So I think the main point to take away this week is that there are lots of different approaches to learning and teaching language, and they're very highly context dependent. So, you know, we're not trying to promote one particular approach. It's very hard to evidence that one approach works better than another. And really you need to consider your context, what's practical for you and what's appropriate for your learners. Many of you, of course, have realised that. So thank you, everybody, for all your contributions. It's been a great week, and I very much look forward to continuing to work with you next week.